Good morning, Highland. We are so thankful that you could join us this morning online. A couple of quick announcements. First off, if you are new with us, if you're joining us for the first time or one of the first times, then we would love to connect with you on the Church Center app. That's the best way to get a hold of us. You download Church Center app in your smartphone, find us, Highland Baptist Church, say, this is my church. Give us your contact information, just basic information, even just an email would be great. We would love to send you more information about the church. And also, it helps us to know who is watching these videos. And so if you're doing that, whether you're here locally around Westminster, Denver area, or across the globe, we would love to know kind of where you are and how we can best minister to you, give you counsel, prayer, and other things. So find us on the Church Center app, download that, and take care of that. That would be wonderful. Also, we have a couple of quick things that are coming up. And you guys, Easter is coming. Resurrection Sunday is almost here, just 6 or so weeks away. And we are so excited for it. Obviously, last year was such a bummer. We couldn't gather in person last year, 2020, because of COVID. But this year we will. And so we are so thankful to the Lord for that. It felt so weird celebrating Easter with just our families in our living rooms. But this year we all get to gather together. And so would love to have you. We are going to offer 3 services. Resurrection Sunday is April 4th. 3 services, 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11 a.m. These will be 60-minute services. These will be music and preaching, a simple celebration of the resurrection of Christ. And so would encourage you guys to sign up for one of those, whichever one fits your schedule. You can register for that. You can actually reserve a spot online. On the Church Center app, go under events and select the service that works for you. We would love for you to sign up for those. We are not going to cap the services, but we are going to try to spread out the crowd a little bit. We're also going to do a Good Friday service this year, April 2nd, just like we always do, one Good Friday service on Friday before Easter. And so you can find that on the Church Center app as well. A couple of things in regard to that. One is we are going to have an Easter choir this year, which we are so excited about. We tried to do it last year. It got canceled. So we're going to do an Easter choir, which means you can sign up for the Easter choir also on the Church Center app. We just want to know how many people to expect in the choir, if that's small or large. We certainly understand if you don't want to be a part of that this year, that's okay. But if you do want to be a part of that, we would love to have you. There will be 4 practices, the 4 Sundays in March, immediately following the late service for about 30, 45 minutes. We are going to do 1 special music number for Easter Sunday. Pray that it blesses the church. And so you can sign up for that on the Church Center app. Also, we've been announcing an evangelism training seminar we're going to have here at the church in preparation for Easter. Our hope is to equip you in a better way, a stronger way to share the gospel, to share your faith with others, your coworkers, neighbors, and friends. And so please come March 5th. You find the information on the Church Center app under events. You can sign up for that. The cost is $7. That's really just going to cover the cost of food. We're going to offer dinner that night as well. Pastor Sam, our youth pastor, is putting together an entire thing on how to share your faith and how to do that effectively. And so would encourage you to come to that March 5th. Find it on the Church Center app. Listen, church, I am so excited to be in God's word with you today and also in worship. Allow me to pray, and then I'll hand it over to Carla, and she can lead us in worship. Lord, we devote this morning to you. We dedicate this service to you, God. It is for you and not for us. Lord, we pray that we would be inspired and challenged by your word, but really we pray that you would bring glory to yourself through the preaching of your word and through the worship of your name. God, thank you for the real forgiveness and joy that we can find in Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, church. Let's sing.
Hello, Highland friends. We are so glad that you're joining us again online, and we're excited to spend the next hour with you, just spending time in God's word and being encouraged together. Today, we have a special passage in Luke that talks about what Jesus says about worry and fear. And he gives us some really beautiful imagery to go along with how he describes God's care for us. So just to help us lead into worship this morning, let's watch a short video together.
What is it today that has you worried, anxious, stressed? Jesus said, look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns. for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field. How they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. So seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything.
Psalm 112, the psalmist says this: Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. He will never be moved. He will be remembered forever. He is not afraid of bad news. His heart is firm, trusting in the Lord. His heart is steady. He will not be afraid. The psalmist could write these words because he knew who his God was. He knows that his God is great, is powerful, is loving and kind and good, and is able to hold him firmly in his hand. And he knows that because of that, he does not need to live in fear or carry worry, the great burden of worry. As we sing together and as we worship, our songs this morning or afternoon, whenever you're watching this, will be centered around who our God is and how able he is to sustain us and lead us through whatever comes. So let's lift him high as we sing together.
Over.
God is with us.
God is with us. He will go before. He will never leave us. He will never leave us. God is for us. He has open arms. He will never fail us. He will never fail us. God is with us. He will go before. He will never leave us. He will never leave us. God is for us. He has open arms. He will never fail us. He will never fail us. Lifted up, he defeated the grave, raised to life. Our God is able. In his name we overcome. For the Lord, our God is able. Lifted up, he defeated the grave, raised to life. Our God is able. In his name we overcome. For the Lord, our God is able. For the Lord, our God is able. For the Lord, our God is able.
God, as we sing words like this right now, and as we hear them, and as we are reminded of what is true, we just ask that you would encourage our hearts. God, so many are walking, carrying burdens that are not theirs to carry. God, we know that you are strong enough to carry even the heaviest things that are on our hearts today. I pray that you would encourage us today, Lord, to remember your great love and care, that we are not alone, that we do not need to live carrying worries, but God, you ask for us to bring them to you. You ask for us to present our requests to you so that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, can guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We thank you for all the ways you have been faithful to us in the past, for all of the hard things that you have carried us through already, and we thank you for those. We thank you in advance for the things that you will show yourself faithful in that are yet to come. God, who can be relied on 100%. And we choose that today. Let's continue to sing.
Grace from the mountain. as an anchor for my soul through every storm. I will hold to you with endless love. All my fear is swept away.
For my soul, our God will stand.
God, we can look back to the cross and see that you won over death. God, nothing is impossible for you. Nothing is too hard for you. Nothing is too big for you. God, you see every single bird on this planet right now. You know each one. You know all the stars by name. You see us, and you love us more than the birds, more than the stars, more than the flowers. You love us the most. That is so hard for us to intake and process the reality of that, but God, we trust your words to us. We trust that we are not alone. We trust that we are in your hand. And we ask that you help us to continue to grow as we walk with you and see your spirit at work in our lives. Teach us, Lord, now we ask in your name. Amen.
Thank you to Carla for leading us, for doing such a good job. Song selection, so gospel-centered, Christ-centered. He really is the object of our praise and the treasure of our hearts. And so thank you to Carla. We'll close again in worship as well after the sermon. But if you have your Bibles, you can open to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, our text this morning is verses 22 to 34. Luke 12, 22 to 34. And our title is Anxiety-Free Living Can Be Yours. Anxiety-Free Living Can Be Yours. If you're able to stand in honor of God's word, I would ask you to do that now as I read. We'll pray and begin. Verse 22 says, "And he said to his disciples, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do a small thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass, which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat, what you are to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be added to you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions, give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." And Lord, we pray a blessing over the preaching and reading of your word. Lord, may we apply it to our hearts and to our minds. May it be living and active. God, not a dead word that we can disregard and neglect, but a living word which changes the way that we live. Lord, I pray that we would renew our minds according to your word, and that we would be different, live differently because of it. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, church. You can be seated. Well, my oldest son, Pearson, is almost 19 years old. He's a freshman in college. And the day that he got saved, the day that he committed his life to Christ, I was explaining the gospel to him. And we were talking about kind of the story of the gospel from Old Testament through New Testament. It was on a road trip. He and I were driving together. And as the conversation became more and more and more real, as things got real, you know, he was 6, 7 years old, somewhere in there. He's understanding things that he's heard. He'd already heard the gospel, but he's understanding it for maybe the first time really deeply. And so as we got more and more and more intense into the gospel, and I'm realizing, man, this is a great opportunity with my son. I kind of pulled my truck over to the side of the road, and we sat there on the side of the road and just talked about the gospel, and I began explaining it to him. And I said this phrase that we often say. I said, you know, Pearson, Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And he kind of got very sad. His countenance kind of dropped. And he said, yeah, Dad, I know. Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And it occurred to me, church, It occurred to me that this little boy had heard that phrase so many times. Jesus died on the cross for our sins. But then the rest of the story, he didn't necessarily fill in. He hadn't heard as many times the rest of the story, which was that Jesus also rose from the dead. And so we got very sad. I know Jesus died on the cross for my sins, very somber. And then I thought, but you know, Pearson, you know, Jesus rose from the dead. He rose from the dead. You know, he's not dead now. And you could, I mean, visibly see his countenance change. Like, he's alive? Yeah, he's alive. Pearson, that's what makes the good news the good news. He's alive. Isn't that good news? And he looked back at me, his sweet little face. He looked back at me and said, Dad, that's great news. That's great news. He's alive. We have said for 18 months, we've been studying the Gospel of Luke. We're about halfway or so done. We have said so many times, church, the Gospel of Luke is the best news. It is the best news for the worst people. If you're one of those people who pretends to be good, good for you. The Gospel of Luke might not be for you. If you're a pretender, a spiritual pretender, man, the Gospel of Luke would say, don't worry about pretending anymore. You can be real. You don't have to hide your sin. You don't have to hide your shame. The Lord already knows everything that you've done, and he has given you his son anyway, who has died on the cross and risen from the dead. It is the best news for the worst people. And if you're sitting here this morning thinking, I could use some good news, then church, listen, I've got good news. It's the good news. Jesus died for your sin, the worst sin that you've ever committed. Died for it. It is paid. It is paid by his grace and through your faith. It is the best news for the worst people. And this morning we come to a well-known text. In this morning's text, Christ pins these words to our hearts using three nails. It's like he nails this text to our hearts using three nails. Three imperatives, commands. Verse 22, stop being anxious. Verse 29, stop worrying. Verse 32, stop being afraid. And this is kind of crazy, but this is now the fourth time I've preached on anxiety at Highland in the last 4 years. Four times in 4 years. You know that sometimes I select the text, but most of the time God selects the text through the sequential preaching of his word. I didn't choose Luke chapter 12. The Lord chose Luke chapter 12. It is the next text in our series. And it caused me to wonder, why would the Lord have me preach this sermon on average once a year? Why anxiety, Lord? It is one of the most frequent subjects that I have preached on here at Highland. Why anxiety? And the obvious answer is because we need to hear it again. Again, we need to hear it. Church, have you ever noticed that we get all bent out of shape over the stupidest stuff? You ever looked at someone, a friend, a neighbor, maybe even just a stranger, you ever looked at them and thought, man, you don't need to live that way. There's a different way to live. You're living without any joy or hope at all. There's a different way that you don't need to live that way. You ever had a neighbor like that? Many years ago, in a different house and on a different street in a different neighborhood, in fact, in a different state, when our family lived in a different state, we had a neighbor who lived across from us whose name was Larry, and he was just the stereotypical grumpy old man. That was him. Stereotype. Every stereotype you can imagine. Grumpy at kids coming to, you know, passing by his front porch, staring out the window at him, yelling at him to get off his lawn. You know, he was that guy. And I just thought, man, that's a hard way to live. Well, that house had these big peaked roofs. Our house had very high peaked roofs, and our family liked hanging Christmas lights, and so I would get up there on the top of these peaks. It was pretty high off the ground, and get up there and hang these Christmas lights. And one year, I was taking our Christmas lights down, getting ready to take them down. I had come to the pinnacle, the very top of that roof, and I lost my footing. I kind of slipped, and I slid just like this, just down. I was going to fall off the roof. I was going to slide right off the roof, totally Christmas vacation, that thing. And man, I was getting ready to go off. I reached where the rain gutters were, right at the edge of the roof, and I just grabbed on. My feet were dangling off. I barely stopped myself from falling off the roof. It scared me to the point that year I never took my Christmas lights down again. We liked having them up. But I kind of tucked them up underneath the eaves so you couldn't really see them from the street. You couldn't see that I was leaving them up. That was kind of cheating. And so I left them up, and for several years we left them up, and I'd plug them in when it was Christmas time and then just unplug them. And you couldn't really tell that there were Christmas lights there. Well, one year I was working out in the spring, working out of my front yard, and the city code enforcement vehicle pulled up. I thought, that's kind of weird. And the guy gets out of his car and, you know, official, the thing, you know, whatever, you know, his insignia polo shirt, you know, city code enforcement. Are you Mr. Gardner? Yes, I'm Mr. Gardner. Well, Mr. Gardner, I've had a complaint from one of your neighbors that you left your Christmas lights up, and city, and you know, city whatever code says you can only leave them up until February 1st, and so you've got to have them down, and it's after that. And he says, you know, it's funny because he said, I drove by your house and I thought, man, there are no Christmas lights. And it wasn't until I got up right next to it that I realized, oh no, there are lights. And you know, I'm sorry, Mr. Gardner, but you're going to need to take them down or you're going to have to face this penalty. And I looked across the street as he pulled up. I looked across the street and I could see Larry peeking out from behind his drapes, watching me. I'm looking at, we made eye contact and I'm like, what is wrong with you? You know, what's your problem? You know, and the guy said, you know, you got 48 hours to take them down, and I'm going to need to come back in 48 hours and make sure that they're down and all this stuff. And I said, you know what? Honestly, don't bother. I said, I'll have them down in 5 minutes. He's like, 5 minutes? I'll have them down in 5 minutes. I walked over to the corner of the yard. He was still standing there. I walked over to the corner of the yard, jumped up and grabbed where the Christmas lights were hanging down, dangling down, grabbed the little cable, and I literally held on and turned and just ran down the street. Like that, ripped them all off at the same time. The code enforcement guy was laughing his head off. All the lights broke, you know, it was fine. But I'm like, man, this is so dumb. This is so dumb. Why are you so nervous? Why are you so worried about Christmas lights? We get fired up about the dumbest stuff. Why? I mean, honestly wonder, why was his life so consumed by my exterior holiday illumination? I mean, it just didn't make any sense. Thought, man, Larry, you might be a little too uptight. It did cause me to think as well, I wonder if he gives his soul the same attention. I wonder if he puts that kind of attention into his soul. I wonder if he puts that kind of attention into the next life rather than this life. And the real question we're going to have to grapple with this morning, church, is this. Is it possible to be so confident in the next life that it strips the stress of this one? Is it possible to be so sure of eternity that it means that you can live an anxiety-free life now? And I believe the answer is yes. We said last week that we are the people who have by far the most possessions in the history of the world. We said that last Sunday. But we also have by far the most wealth, by far the most modern conveniences, by far the greatest technology, by far, church, the greatest medical care in the history of mankind. The most money, the most stuff, the best health care. We should be, based on that logic, we should be the most carefree people in history. Right? And yet, we are racked with anxiety, worry, paranoia. We develop nervous tics and quirks. We struggle with social anxiety, phobias, PTSD, and all of those things were before COVID. I'm not even talking about 2020. You know, post-global pandemic, we're now dealing with drug abuse, alcohol abuse, and suicide like never before in modern history. All of those things, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, and suicide, have gone through the roof in the last 12 months. It turns out that the infamous poet, philosopher, Notarius, and I might be mispronouncing his name, might have been right when he said, I don't know what they want from me. It's like the more money we come across, the more problems we see. One man has said, worry is a thin stream of fear trickling through the mind. If encouraged, it cuts a channel into which all the other thoughts are drained. Did you catch that? Worry cuts this little stream through the mind. And he says, if left unchecked, if not shored up, if not taken care of, that little tiny stream of worry allows all the thoughts of our brain just to leak out. We can't think about anything else once we get worried. One pastor has said, you may start with just a little worry, but it can engulf your whole life. And church, we take courses, we speak with counselors about stress management. We called it stress management. But honestly, I don't want to manage my stress. I want to kill it. I don't want to manage it as if I'm the manager of the baseball team. That's not what I want. I want to kill stress. And Christ says that anxiety-free living is available to you right now. Right now, it is yours for the taking. You can get rid of stress. You can get rid of fear. You can get rid of paranoia. You can get rid of worry. We call exterminators for rats and mice and roaches, but Christ is the exterminator for anxiety. Call him, church. He will kill it. He will exterminate it. The English word worry comes from a German word, Wurgen, Wurgen with a W, Wurgen, okay? That's where we get the English word worry. Wurgen in German means to strangle. That's where we get the English word worry from. It chokes, it strangles, and isn't that true? Worry is mental and spiritual strangulation. That's what worry does. And I know that many of our beloved Highlanders, members of our church family, my own friends, are being mentally strangled by worry. Last Sunday, Jesus concluded a mini sermon on being rich toward God. It was a reminder that wealth is a tool. Your wealth is meant to be invested in the kingdom, right? Don't store up treasure for yourself on earth. Store up treasure for yourself in heaven. In fact, Jesus even finishes his sermon today, this morning, with that same idea. Store up treasure for yourself there. Take hold of that life, which is truly life, we said last week. And today, this morning, Christ follows up with a command against anxiety. You can almost hear his audience thinking, but if I don't stockpile, who will take care of me? If I don't hoard my wealth, won't I eventually run out? It's like a year ago when we were asking, how am I going to get enough toilet paper? Right? These people are going to Costco and King Super, and they're walking out of there with buckets and buckets and buckets, trunks full of toilet paper, thinking we were going to run out of toilet paper. I thought, that's the most idiotic thing I've ever seen. And he says, that's how we treat our money. It's like, oh, get as much as I can, because what if I run out? What if I run out? Who will take care of me? Who will safeguard me against murder hornets? I mean, there's just so many stupid things. The reality is that many, many, many Christians, church, whether genuine believers or not, is up to the Lord, but many, many, many Christians are the thorny soil that once received the seed, whose plant sprung up quickly, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desire for other things enter in, and Jesus says, choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. Choke the word. It's interesting that he uses that phrase, that word picture. It chokes the word. It is worry. It is vergen. It is that strangulation, mental and spiritual strangulation. And so let's turn our attention to God's word, what he says about mental and spiritual strangulation brought on by anxiety. You're going to notice first that worry misunderstands God's promise. Worry misunderstands God's promise. Look at verse 22. He said to his disciples, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life. You're going to notice that's an imperative. That is a command. This is not a suggestion. This is not a question. This is him telling you, if you are worrying, you are being unfaithful, is what he says. You're disobeying his word. If you are living in worry, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. You know, daily living, the eating of food, the wearing of clothes, was an actual concern of Jesus' original hearers. Their daily activities revolved around surviving. I mean, when I put together my daily calendar, it's not how can I stay alive today. I very rarely ever consider that fact. You know, like, I really don't. It's like, who do I got to meet with, and what do I have to read, and what do I have to study, and how am I going to accomplish that, and all of that. It's not about, am I going to stay alive today? That's not what I'm worried about, but that is what they were worried about. Food and clothing. They grew their own food. They butchered it. They harvested it. They cooked it themselves. They made their own clothes. They traded for them. There was no going through the Wendy's drive-thru on their way to Flatirons Mall. That's not how they lived. That's how we lived. That's not how they lived. When Jesus commanded the rich fool last week not to store food and wealth for himself, this would have required a tremendous step of faith. And so he begins with this imperative, don't worry about food and clothing. Look at verse 23. For life is more than food and the body more than clothing. food and fashion. He says, you cannot boil your life down to food and fashion. And yet consider how much of our culture, 2021 American culture, is based on food and fashion. Maybe worded better this way. How much of 2021 American culture is obsessed with food and fashion? How much of our retail is based on food or fashion? How much of our economy, food and fashion? What percentage of square footage in our malls? I mean, Flatiron's Crossing up there, it's a huge building. Food and fashion, those are the two things it's devoted to. Shopping centers, food and fashion. 16th Street Mall in downtown Denver, food and fashion. All of those, well, and smoking, okay? Those are the three things. But food and fashion, that's really what it is. Pearl Street up there in Boulder, food and fashion is devoted to those two enterprises. And here Christ simply says, life is more than food and fashion. In other words, we are more than animals. We are more than our daily needs. Animals exist for this earth, for this life. When this life is over, that's it, but not us. We exist for more than this life. And so, church, we need not scramble over toilet paper. I mean, that would be the modern application of this a year ago. Stockpiling toilet paper. How crazy are we? We need not scramble over those things. Do you think the Lord doesn't know that you need that stuff? I mean, honestly, over food, over clothes, even over vaccines, we don't need to scramble over those things. And I know some of you are like, oh, Danny, are you saying we don't need food and clothes? Are you saying I shouldn't get the vaccine? No, don't miss the point, church. That is not what I'm saying. Don't misunderstand. Of course we need food. Of course we need clothes. Of course vaccines are a good thing. Of course they are. You know, I'm so thankful that none of my sons will ever get polio. They'll never get it. I mean, I'm so thankful for that. What I am saying is this. There is a divine promise. There is a divine promise. Live for God and he will care for you. That's the divine promise. He is saying, I will take care of your daily needs. You don't have to scramble to get enough stuff. You don't. I will care for those things. So you live for me and I will care for you. That is the promise of God. And honestly, church, he could not say it any clearer than how he says it down in verse 31 of the same text. Look down just a little bit, verse 31. Instead of scrambling after food and fashion, instead of scrambling after these things, he says, seek his kingdom, verse 31, and these things will be added to you. These things, your daily needs, will be added to you. God says, you live for me, seek my kingdom, I will care for your daily needs. That's first. Worry misunderstands God's promise. But notice second, worry misunderstands God's provision. Look up at verse 24. Worry misunderstands God's provision. Consider, he says, the ravens, consider the birds. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon, he is the richest man who ever lived, right? You can imagine what clothes he wore. Even Solomon, in all of his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. In all of his splendor, never as beautiful as a flower. Is what he's saying. Verse 28, but if God so clothes the grass, which is alive in the field today and which tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, all you of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat and what you're to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things. Your Father knows that you need them. The gist of this exhortation is that a believer need not be anxious simply because God is their heavenly Father. You say, Pastor Danny, why do I need not worry? And I would tell you, because you know the creator and sustainer of the universe. God is your heavenly Father. Now, the people of the gods of the nations, all of those false gods, those people, they should worry, right? Because they don't know the creator and sustainer of the universe. And so they should be worried. because their God is not listening to them. Their God is impotent. He cannot take care of business. He doesn't have any power over the birds and the flowers. But your God is the Father of heaven. Even birds, he says, relatively small and insignificant, have figured this out. Birds don't worry. They absolutely trust God for their provision of food every day. No clothes designer, not Ralph Lauren or Marc Jacobs or Michael Kors or Vera Wang. No clothes designer has ever come up with and produced a design as beautiful as the wildflowers which grow in the cracks of our sidewalks. Those little tiny flowers that grow in the cracks, the seams of cement, are more beautiful than anything Vera Wang has ever put out. Right? I mean, even the most talented people, fashion designers, can't come up with stuff as good as God just makes here today and gone tomorrow. God cares for the birds. He cares for the flowers, and yet no bird is made in God's image. No bird has a new nature in Christ. The flowers are so temporary. They're here for a day. How much more valuable than a bird are you? How much longer do you live than the grass and the flowers? Do you see what he's arguing here? You're certainly more valuable than these things, and he cares for those. Why would he not care for you? We who have the privilege of knowing God through Christ should know to a far greater degree that if God has provided huge things for us, like salvation in Jesus' name, if he has provided his own son for you, then he will certainly provide mundane things like food, clothing, and longevity. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. Listen to what this says. Romans 8, 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? He says, if God gave his son for you, he's going to make sure you've got clothes to put on. If God gave his son for you, he will certainly make sure that you have food to eat. Church, if God gave his son for you, if he gave his own son, if he struck down his own child for you, then certainly he will see you through a pandemic. You do not need to worry. God has all things under control. I like that he even says in verse 25, and which of you by being anxious can add a single hour to his span of life? So he says, not only is worry going against, is it a mistrust in the sovereignty of God and his care for you, but on top of that, it doesn't even work. It doesn't work. Which of you by worrying can make yourself live longer? I've heard of people dying early from worry, right? Causing heart problems and high blood pressure and other things. I've heard them dying early from worry, but I've never heard of somebody living longer because they were worried. It doesn't even work. And I love that he concludes this little section of verse 30 by just calling out the nations. He just says, for all the nations of the world, they seek after that stuff. Your Father knows that you need it all. You don't need to seek it. I think one great feature of heathenism, worshiping false gods, okay, non-Christians, non-believers, one great feature of theirs is living for the present. They live for the present. That's all they can see, right? Live it up today because tomorrow we're going to die. It is that living for the present is the dominant worldview of most college campuses, if we're honest, right? That's how college students live, at least the non-Christian ones, acting as if they were designed for earthly pleasures. But that type of thinking is not worthy of the child of God. It's not even worthy of you. We weren't designed for those things. Those things were designed for us. And so, church, live not like your heathen neighbors. Live differently than they do. Let a nobler and more essential and more satisfactory object occupy your affections and desires, your attention and your energies. And if God were to occupy the principal place in your heart, you would not be the lesser for it. One pastor has said, when we think like the world, when we crave like the world, we will worry like the world. And so let us not live like the world does. He says, if you do, you're just proving that you have very little faith. In fact, he says as much in verse 28, O you of little faith. He really punches home the problem. Worry, anxiety, and stress are the opposite of faith. So finally, we saw that Worry misunderstands God's promise. It also misunderstands his provision. But notice finally, worry misunderstands God's pleasure. Worry misunderstands God's pleasure. He says something interesting in verse 32. Fear not. Do not be afraid. Right? Do not be afraid. Fear not, little flock. For it is your Father's good. Look at the next word. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Did you know that God, the Father, actually finds pleasure in providing for you? It brings him pleasure to do so. He takes pleasure in providing for you. He enjoys providing for you the same way that a parent takes pleasure in providing for their child. You know, and I think sometimes the more money we have, remember the context of this sermon is just last week him saying, be rich toward God. Don't be rich on earth, be rich toward God. But the more money we have, the broader our financial base becomes, the more tempted we are to think that our provision, rather than coming from God, that our provision actually comes from securities or dividends or portfolios. And he says that's not where it comes from. God actually takes pleasure in providing for you. And look what he says in verse 33. It's almost like he's saying, test God in this. Test him. Sell your possessions. Give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that don't grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Here the Lord kind of issues this challenge. Test the Father in this. Try getting rid of it all. Just get rid of it all and see if God still doesn't provide for you. He will. He will, because you're his beloved child. See how he provides. You know, church, we really can say along with the psalmist, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I shall not want for anything. The Lord is my shepherd and he cares for me. You know, church, the gist of it is, the bottom line is, worrying is unworthy of the people of God. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, then worry is unworthy of you. And I believe that it is unworthy for a whole host of reasons, but allow me to give you three. Why does worry have no place in your life? First, because it is a complete waste of time. Worrying is a waste of time. We've been given a limited number of seconds to walk this earth. Each of them, each one of those seconds that you are alive is precious. It is a precious opportunity to glorify God and to bring others into loving knowledge of him. Colossians chapter 4 and verse 5 says to walk in wisdom toward outsiders, redeeming or making the best use of the time. Walk in wisdom toward those who don't know Jesus. Make the best use of the time. In other words, don't waste the time that God has given you to advance his kingdom. Don't waste that time on worry. It is a waste of time. But also second, why is worry unworthy of you if you are in Christ? Because second, many of the future things that you worry about will never come to pass. Man, how many days and weeks and months have been wasted worrying about things that will never happen? One has said this, J.C. Ryle. He says, half our miseries are caused by fancying things that we think are coming upon us. Half the things we expect to come upon us never come at all. He says, you worry half your life. You waste half your life over things that will never come to pass. That's second. But third, why is it unworthy? Because worrying about the future has no hope of changing the future. Your worry will be ineffective. Not only is it a waste of time, and not only will a lot of those things you're worried about never happen, but worrying doesn't work. It'd be one thing to say, well, yeah, Pastor Danny, but if I worry about it, I've noticed the results are a lot better. Nobody ever says that. The results are actually a lot worse. Worrying about tomorrow, you'll notice, everybody knows this. Worrying about tomorrow does not empty tomorrow of its trials. Have you noticed that? Being worried doesn't save you from trials. Rather, all worrying about tomorrow will do is empty today of its joy. That's all you're doing. You're not fixing tomorrow. You're just ruining today. Arthur Pink has said, cross not your bridges before you come to them, but cheerfully shoulder the burden of today and trustfully leave the future to God. Now listen to what he says. This is awesome. Tomorrow, he says, after all, will bring with it tomorrow's God. You don't need to worry about tomorrow. Do you know why, church? Because tomorrow, when you get there, God will already be there. He'll already be there. It'd be one thing to say, well, if tomorrow God's not there, then we have something to worry about. But God has already promised. He is the God who will be there tomorrow. Tomorrow will bring with it tomorrow's God. And so we can say, like David says in Psalm 37, I've been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor have I seen his children begging for bread. He says, I'm an old man. I have never seen God forsake his promise. So church, you ever think to yourself, I wish I didn't have to live this way? Are you racked with anxiety and worry? Or are you confident in the next life? If you're confident in the next life, then you do not need to worry about this one by your worry. Are tomorrow's trials really being emptied, or is your worry just instead stripping you of your joy, strangling today's joy? And God, I pray that you would help us to trust in your sovereignty. We know, Lord, that you can do all things. You have all things under control. We know those things, but we don't always live that way. And God, I pray that we would trust. When we are prone to worry, may we trust in your promises, in your providence, and in your pleasure. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you again for joining us, church. Carlo's going to close us now in song.
Father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived. goodness of God.
Lord, we thank you for reminding us of your great care for us today. Help us to walk in that, to walk in the freedom and the joy of knowing who you are, and that you have us firmly in your hand, that you are so faithful to lead us and show us how to walk in your promises. Continue to grow our hearts, grow our faith, we ask in your name. Pray that this time would not be just something that we do, Lord, but that it would be used to continue to transform us to become more like Jesus. And that's our prayer we ask in your name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us again. We know it's hard to be online sometimes, and God is going to bless your faithfulness to continue to seek him and walk in his ways. And we hope that you guys leave today encouraged. We'll see you next time.